chapter 2. But what is Christmas all about? Now, there was a Sunday school teacher that asked her class of kindergartners to draw a picture of the manger scene. Well, she was going around looking at the different pictures, and one little girl had drawn a picture of a very plump man, very jolly fella, beside the manger scene. And so she's noticed that. She thought, well, this little girl must be drawing Santa Claus in there or something. And she says, I see this character here, she asked the student. Tell me about him. And the little girl said, well, that's Round John Virgin. And I don't know, you'll get that later on maybe, but Round John Virgin. It's kind of like the Andy Walks With Me and Andy, who is Andy. But, you know, there's no question about, there's no confusion about the Word of God. The Bible is very clear, and let's read in Luke chapter 2, just beginning there at verse 8 down through verse 12. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. I mean, they were scared to death. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy. By the way, that was always a good thing when you heard an angel at this time to say, fear not. There were other angels that came that wasn't such a pleasant experience. And so that's why they were afraid. But they said, fear not. He brings them great joy, which will be to all people. For unto you, verse 11, is born this day in the city of David a what?
Savior.
A Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe, that Savior of the world, wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Our Heavenly Father, I pray that you help us all, from the youngest here to the oldest, to glean from this message what you would want for all of us. Lord, I thank you for your word. Help me, Lord, not to stumble and stammer, but to preach with power, with clarity. And I pray that everyone here would be able to hear it and understand it and then apply these truths to their life. Help the kids sit up straight. May they not try to take a nap. May we not be on our phones. May we not be trying to do something else to allow the devil to distract us, but to focus in on you, and we make you a priority today. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Now, too often in our efforts to celebrate Christmas, and everybody knows about Christmas, we get confused about what we are celebrating. We get confused about why we are celebrating. In fact, if the truth be known, oftentimes people get confused on who we're celebrating, who it is that is the reason for celebrating Christmas. And that's why today I want to take some time to reflect on the true meaning of Christmas. What it's all about. What is Christmas all about? But Christmas is all about God sending his son to this earth. Christmas wasn't man's idea. It was God's idea. And Christmas wasn't man's initiative. It was God's initiative. Christmas came about because of God. Now, today I want us to think about the reasons why God did what he did. The reasons for Christmas, why it occurred in the first place. Why did Jesus come to this earth? And number one, Christmas occurred because of God's desire. You know God has a desire? You know, you all, a lot of young people today, you have a desire. You want something for Christmas. You've got a list you've made. And maybe some of you adults do too. But this is the Lord Jesus Christ's birthday that we're celebrating. What is his desire? Well, Christmas came about because of God's desire. Here's one of his desires. He desires to embrace us with his love. Did you know that God loves you? Listen, there's nothing you can ever do to cause God not to love you or to love you any less. So you may be here this morning and you're not right with God and you know it. But I want you to know God loves you no less than he has always loved you. He wants you, he has a desire for you to live right and to do right, but it has changed, not changed his love at all. Look at verse 10 there again. It says, I bring you the angel's song or message I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. Now, this world is filled with a lot of people who are very lonely. Very lonely. And they feel like they are unloved. They feel like no one cares for them. No one loves them. Pollsters say that 1 out of 5 Americans say life is meaningless. Excuse me. People do get lonely. In fact, we all get lonely at one time or another. There was an advertisement that was placed in a local newspaper years back that said for $5, they would be able to call this number and that person would listen to them for 30 minutes. And by the way, the response was overwhelming. And their phone was ringing off the hook. People do get lonely. The renowned Albert Einstein once said, "It's strange to be known so universally and yet to be so personally lonely." But folks, Christians, we are not alone, are we? We're not alone. Not with Christ. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." He loves each and every one of us. And as if, listen, he loves you as if you are the only one on this earth. He loves you that much. And never forget the love of God. A young man sent a love letter to his girlfriend, and it read something like this: "Darling, I'll climb the highest mountain for you. Darling, I'll cross the roughest oceans for you, and I'll even cross the hottest desert and just to see you." And then he put a little P.S. in the notes, said, "P.S., if it rains Saturday, I won't be by." And so we chuckle at his fickleness, but we feel bad for that young lady, like all of us, who longs for love in action, not just empty words, not just empty promises. Because of what Christ has done, it's not empty words. God does not offer empty promises of love. And by sending his only begotten Son to die for our sins, he demonstrated his love for us. Romans 5:8, "But God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." So because of Christ's sacrifice for us on the cross, we, through faith in him, we enter into a love relationship. A relationship with God himself that is everlasting. Let me ask you this. Paul asked this question: can anything separate us from the love of God, from the love of Christ? Well, the answer is a resounding no. But listen to the response here. Paul says, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us." And he goes on, he says, I'm persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans 8, the latter part of that chapter. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. And then another thing, he has a desire to not only embrace us with his love, but he has a desire to encourage us with his peace. Verse 10, the angel said, "Fear not." The shepherds were afraid because they encountered the glory of the Lord. They could not even look upon these angels. They had such fear. Why? Because they knew they were sinners. And they knew these beings were from God. And they had... they could not stand before them. They trembled in the presence of God. But you know what? Jesus Christ came that we no longer have to tremble. Jesus Christ came that we no longer have to be afraid. Jesus Christ came that we can have the kind of relationship where we can go and approach the throne of God without fear and boldly make our request known unto him. And so knowing their sinfulness. They were afraid, but these angels brought this great message of God's forgiveness. Aren't you glad for the forgiveness of God? Many today believe that salvation does not come through Jesus Christ and Christ alone. They say, well, that's an awful narrow message. A lot of people believe something different. Well, you are right about that. They believe something different. But anything different is a hopeless destination, really. You're in a hopeless situation without Christ, without direction. Jesus Christ will save you if you will come to him as you are. Jesus Christ will save you if you will come to him. It says in Romans chapter 5, verse 1, therefore, being justified, how? By faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And then also he came not only to embrace us, to encourage us. And let me remind you, you're doing good, young people. Let's try to sit still, though, and listen to the preaching here this morning. But to enrich us with his glory. God wants to make you rich. Not in the area of finances, but in his glory. He says in verse 10, he wants to give us great joy. There's a story of a large stone cathedral in Europe that was very large, very magnificent. And inside this cathedral was a beautiful pipe organ. It was very, very large itself. And just an unbelievable size, a beautiful pipe organ. It was Saturday afternoon. No one was supposed to be around. The fellow that was cleaning the church, the custodian, was making one final check, and he went up into the balcony and up into the choir and organ loft, and he was there high in the balcony when he suddenly heard some steps coming up these stone stairs, and it kind of startled him because he knew the doors were locked, no one was there. And he looked around, he saw a man who was just slightly tattered and had traveling clothes on, and he didn't think that he probably was there to get something. But he said, excuse me, sir, this stranger said to this custodian. He said, I've come from quite a distance to see the great organ in this cathedral. And would you mind opening the council that I might get a closer look at it? The custodian says, no way. He said, I'll get in trouble if I do that. Well, this stranger, he said, listen, I've come a long way. I just want to look at it. Would you mind? So finally he gave in. And then he said, well, listen, oh, that's magnificent. Would you mind if I just sat on the bench? And the guy said, oh, man, I don't know. And finally, again, the guy talked him into it. He sits on the bench, and he could see right away, the custodian could see this man knew his way around the pipe organ. And he said, sir, would you mind if I just play a few notes on the organ? And the custodian says, sir, I can't do that. I'll lose my job if I let you do that. They've got it all set. They're ready for tomorrow's service. And again, the guy would not, he just looked at him like he was so sorrowful and said, I've come such a long way. Would you mind? And finally, the guy did. He let him play. And when he started playing, this custodian said, I've never heard anything like it. It's like it transported me into the very gates of heaven. The music filled the entire church, and it was beautiful. And when he got done, in fact, he played more than a few notes. But when he stopped, the custodian said, wait a minute, you're not stopping now. Can't you go on? But the man got up. He walked out, down the stairs, and the custodian asked him, said, wait. He said, that was beautiful music beyond anything I've ever heard out of this organ. Who are you? And the stranger turned. He replied, and this name doesn't mean that much to many of us here, but his name was Mandelosa, and Mandelosan. And the man was none other than Felix Mandelosan, one of the greatest organists and composers of the 19th century. And so the custodian, now he was all alone in the building, in this great cathedral. And this beautiful organ music was still ringing in his ears. And he said to himself, just think. He said, I almost kept the master from playing his music in my cathedral. Now, each one of us has the opportunity to have a personal relationship with God. But just think, many of us, or many individuals, many people have not allow the master of the universe, Jesus Christ, to take control and to play his music in our life. So let's not keep him from playing his music and letting him, let's allow him to be the master of our lives. Allow him to be the master of our lives. Sit up. All right. Let Jesus Christ have his way, his rule, his control. He said, I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly in John 10:10. Jesus Christ does not, and listen, he's not a taskmaster where he's cruel and uncaring and unloving with no compassion at all. In fact, the exact opposite is true. The Lord loves us. He wants us to have abundant life. Sometimes we get in our minds that we're being shortchanged, that we're missing out. The devil tells us that. But the devil's a liar. There's nothing greater than being right where God wants you to be. In fact, if you're not saved here today, there's nothing greater than knowing for sure that you're going to go to heaven when you die. Notice that the angel spoke not just of the joy, but of great joy. Christmas occurred because of God's desire. And also, it occurred because of God's design, by God's design. In sending his son, Jesus Christ, his only begotten son, to earth, it was God's design that Christ would be or would fulfill the scripture. Do you know all the prophecies in the Old Testament? Everything that listed there about who Jesus was or the coming Savior would be? Jesus fulfilled all of those prophecies, every one of them. And it was prophesied thousands of years before this. In fact, in verse 11, it says there, uses that phrase, in the city of David. The angels refer to the fact that the birth of Jesus Christ was prophesied in the Old Testament in the book of Micah, chapter 5, verse 2, concerning the fact that Jesus would be born in Bethlehem. In the Old Testament, there's over 300 prophecies of the first coming. And then there's over 500 of the second coming. But those prophecies were fulfilled in Jesus Christ in his first coming, and they will be fulfilled in his second coming. George Heron, a French mathematician, calculated that the odds of one man fulfilling only 40 of the prophecies are 1 in 10 to the power of 157. Now, if you're not a mathematician, that doesn't mean a whole lot. But that is a 1 followed by 157 zeros. Compared to it, this, you know, your odds of winning the state lottery are 14 followed by 6 zeros. So the odds of someone fulfilling all of the prophecies of the Old Testament, as did Jesus, even if he fulfilled 30 of them, would be beyond our imagination. And imagine that we were to bring 40 different artists together. And these 40 artists, they were renowned artists. We were going to ask them to draw or to paint this picture, these different artists, various skills, various backgrounds. And we took this large canvas and we cut it up into 40 pieces. And so we give this guy a piece, and then we want them to draw or to paint this image of the Messiah. And then we're going to take all these 40 pieces and put them back together, and they're going to be a perfect image of Jesus Christ. Now you say, that'd be impossible. It'd be impossible to do. Well, that's kind of what's happened here. It's exactly what happened. The mosaic of the writings of all the prophets of old, different times, hundreds of years apart from one another. And they began to flow and fit together like a glove perfectly, because the Lord Jesus, the Lord was in control. He was the one inspiring them to write. In the canonization of the Old Testament, the prophecy comes clear. And a single stream flows to this ultimate climax when God, when he said that I reveal myself to these people at this level, at that level. They're at different levels spiritually, different times in the scale of time. And until the revelation of myself comes to its fulfillment. What was the fulfillment of that? Of revealing himself to mankind? It was the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, being sent to this earth to die for our sins. So Jesus is at the center of all of Christmas. That's what it's all about. It's not about all those other things that we are distracted with. Let's not forget that this year. Mary and Joseph traveled to Bethlehem in order that the prophecy might be fulfilled in the providence of God. And there, in fulfillment of prophetic scripture, Jesus Christ was born, just like it said there in the book of Micah, thousands of years before. Then also, he not only to fulfill scripture, but also to provide our salvation. Why did Jesus come? To provide our salvation. Hey, girls, listen up. Look up this way. Zariah, I'm going to have to move you if you don't look up here. You're talking. Okay, I'm sorry about that. I'm trying to help these kids. They're still, I just want you to listen. At least don't be talking while I'm talking. But he is at the center of everything, and he's come to provide salvation. Look at verse 11. For unto you is born this day in the city of David. Again, what does it say? A what?
Savior.
A Savior. He has designed, he's provided salvation. If our greatest need had been information, God would have sent an educator. If our greatest need had been technology, God would have sent us a scientist. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent us an economist. But our greatest need are not those things. Our greatest need is for our sins to be forgiven, for our soul to be saved. And he sent his only begotten perfect
Amen.
Son. God has provided salvation. Our greatest need, mankind's greatest need, is to be forgiven. So God sent a Savior. There was a young father who was on a hike with his daughter, and they were going up into the mountains. It was a beautiful day. There was a nice breeze blowing. And as they were going along, his little girl got bit by a rattlesnake. She spooked the snake, and it bit her in the leg. And she screamed down and began to cry, and her daddy took her and took his knife and kind of cut in that wound and then sucked the poison out. And he spit it because there was no hospital close by. Yeah, it was icky. They finally got the little girl to the hospital, and she was all right. But then the doctors began to examine her father. He was beginning to feel pretty bad. He had a sore in his mouth, and that poison got into his blood, and he died. That father, by the way, a true father is not going to even be concerned about that anyway. To save his life of his child, he'll give his life. And that's exactly what what Jesus did for us. He died so that you might live, so that we might live. His death on the cross paid the price for our sins. The one who lives eternally came to die so that we who are dying eternally might come to live. So then he also not only did he come to bring salvation and to fulfill scriptures, but he also came to rule as sovereign. Look at verse 11, which is Christ the Lord. Praise God, as a Christian, I'm going to live forever. And they're going to, but I don't go around, you know, with that in mind saying, you know, hey, I want you to know I'm going to live forever and everybody's going to know who I am. I am so special. I'm more special than anybody else. No, but listen, that some in the world do that. That line of thinking is from a lot in this world who think I'm going to live forever and everybody's going to know my name. And we often fail in that area. We fall into the temptation of wanting the acclaim of all those around us, the applause of man. Many people go to almost any length to assure everyone's going to know who I am. Everyone's going to remember my name. And many infamous names that you will never forget. Bonnie and Clyde. Mm-hmm. Babyface Nelson. That's a very infamous name. Hitler. Everybody knows who
yep.
he is. Charles Manson.
Yep.
And those are just a few. Yeah, there's a lot of others we could name. But then there are the rich and famous. But the name that is above every name, the name that means more than any other name, is Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus Christ. And so he came to die for our sins, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. Think about that. You can bow today and know him as your Savior. Or you can reject him. You could curse him. And then, but one day you will bow the knee and you'll know him as your judge. Let me get to my last point and I'm done here. Not only do we see that Christmas is about God's desire, and we also see that it's through God's decision. It's all about God's decision. In verse 12, look there one more time in Luke chapter 2, verse 12. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes lying in a manger. He, God, decided to become as a man. He come as a man. You shall find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes. God came to walk among us so that he might wrap his arms around us. Hebrews chapter 4, listen to these verses. I'll read them slow. Verses 14 through 16. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was at all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. Amen. So he decided to come as a man. He knows what you're going through. He knows the pain you feel. He knows the need you have. He decided to come. He also decided to call out to men. Look what it says there. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find this babe. Jeremiah 29, verse 13 and 14. And ye shall seek me, the Lord says. And you know what it says right after that? And you'll find me. If you want to find the Lord, he's there. He's not hiding. He's inviting you to come to him. You shall seek me and you shall find me. And when you shall search for me with all your heart, and I will find be found of you, saith the Lord. Far from the city of Jerusalem, Israeli postal workers, they sort through these huge piles of mail, of undelivered mail, or they are classified as undeliverable mail, and including among those dead letters are many that are addressed to God, and people sent them to Jerusalem. And so some have been forwarded by foreign postal workers who think, well, someone in Israel, they should know where how to get this to God and or what to do with them. And eventually all of these petitions to God end up in a recycling plant in central Israel. Well, listen, Jesus said, you don't have to send a letter. In fact, you don't even have to send a text. It's a lot quicker than a text. It's a lot quicker than any electronic device that we have. All you have to do is call upon him. Because he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. So he is the way. Unless our communications with God are addressed John 14:6, then they're sure to have the same fate as those dead letters in Israel. Unless you come through Jesus Christ, you're never going to get to heaven. Jesus is the only way that you can make a connection with God. And that's why he came. That's what Christmas is all about. Let me ask you today, do you know him? If you were to die right now, do you know for sure that you'd go to heaven? So, Pastor, I've gone to church for many years. I've gotten baptized, and that's fine, but I'm not asking you that. I'm saying, do you know personally that if you died right now, you'd go to heaven? So I don't hope so or think so, you know so. If not, let me invite you to trust him today. That's what Christmas is all about. That's why Jesus came, so that you and I might be saved, that you and I might have a home in heaven. Let's bow our heads together in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, I thank you for everyone here. I pray, Lord, I pray your blessings upon them. But I especially pray for anyone that's here, young or old, that's not sure they're saved. They're not so certain that they're going to heaven. Oh, I pray that they would allow you to have your way with their heart today. They'd come and say, Lord, I want forgiveness. I want salvation. And then call upon you to save them. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So you work in their hearts today. And Lord, you have your way in this invitation, and we give you all the glory. Help us as Christians to never forget that we have what Christmas is all about, what we are celebrating here. And we have all that we have because of Jesus. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.